It's a great pleasure that we're having, hosting Susan this evening. I actually had never heard of Susan, sorry about that. About a year ago, and my good friend Donna called me on the phone, and we had been discussing doing something for the 100-year anniversary of Fathom, something that we felt through our Rosary group that Mary had placed on our heart, to find a way to honor Our Lady and to do some special things and for her and to have speakers. And Donna called me, and she was so excited. She said, "You have to hear Susan Conroy. She's perfect. You have to get her. She'll just love her." So I immediately went, of course, to the computer and Googled her and found her on EWTN. And the thing that struck me so profoundly about her when I was hearing her interview was her joy, was the joy that she radiated, the joy that can only come from a beautiful relationship with God and also with our mother. And so because of that, I was completely convinced that she had to come and speak. So I counted her. She was very sweet and agreed to come. But you may have read some of her books. She's an author, and she's also a speaker. She travels around and often speaks about her relationship with Saint Mother Teresa and her 11-year relationship with her. But she's also spoken on different subjects, and she just completed a new series on EWTN, Coming to Christ, on Edward Zecker, and right on location on the coast of Maine, where she's from, in the South Portland area. And so that you can look forward to seeing that. Also, after this presentation, you can go over to the center, what's it called, the center?
Parish
Center. And for some coffee and dessert, and also to be able to look at some of the things that she's written for sale there, and also she'll sign some copies for you too. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Marie, and thank you, Father Vaughn, for inviting me to come and speak this evening. Father told me this evening upon arrival that you're very relaxed and down to earth here, and so he said I could call him by his first name, Father. But I feel very much at home now. I can call you Father. It's a thrill, it's a joy to be here with you, to speak especially about our Blessed Mother Mary. And I'll just admit to you right now, I'll confess to you right away that I'm a mother's girl. I'm very much a mother's girl. And I tell people that my two favorite female role models in the whole world, my two favorite female role models are Blessed Mother Mary and my mama. And also, as Marie mentioned, most often as I travel around the country and sometimes to other countries to give presentations, it's about Mother Teresa of Calcutta, St. Teresa of Calcutta. And this evening, as I focus mostly on the Blessed Mother Mary, I will do so also in the context of two things: Our Lady of Fatima, and Our Lady as I learned to love her from Mother Teresa of Living, a saint, St. Teresa of Calcutta, St. Mother Teresa of Calcutta. Before I begin, just a little overview for those of you who don't know, who weren't aware of this. As Marie said, I knew Mother Teresa of Calcutta over the course of 11 years. I had a relationship with Mother Teresa over the course of 11 years, and it all started, I was actually living in New Hampshire at the time. I was at college here in New Hampshire. This is where I went to school. Even though I'm from Maine, I was at college in New Hampshire when I made my very first trip to Calcutta, India, across the whole planet Earth, and showed up at Mother's doorstep, Mother Teresa of Calcutta's doorstep, to help offer my hands and heart to help her serve the poorest of the poor. I just celebrated my birthday. I just turned 21 years old when I made that first journey. And at college, they called me a pioneer in India, blazing a trail from New Hampshire to Mother Teresa's doorstep in India. And I was the first student that had done that, and it dramatically changed the course of my life. Volunteering every morning in Mother Teresa's children's orphanages, taking care of abandoned and malnourished babies and children, and every afternoon volunteering in Mother Teresa's famous Home for the Dying, taking care of sick and dying people whom we literally lifted up out of the gutters of Calcutta to tend to, administer to, literally till their last breath. But what was exciting about being with Mother Teresa was her intense spiritual life. It was unlike anything I experienced in my life. Every single morning started with Holy Mass with Mother Teresa and Missionaries of Charity. And then we would go forth to serve, to love and to serve others, the babies, the orphans, the people with leprosy, the sick, the dying. And then every evening we'd have Holy Hour of Adoration at Mother Teresa's house. So we started by receiving Jesus in Holy Communion, and we went forth to serve Jesus in his distressing disguise as a poor. Then we came back to the convent to adore Jesus and to thank him and praise him. So it was one of the most spiritually nourishing experiences of my whole life, working with Mother Teresa and the Missionaries of Charity, and it dramatically changed the course of my life. Many people don't realize and don't know that Mother Teresa, as the foundress of the Missionaries of Charity, she obeyed Jesus and started the Missionaries of Charity to go forth into the dark and unhappy homes of the poor, so the poor in Calcutta, to serve the poor among her. And but many people don't realize that Mother Teresa's entire religious order is dedicated to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. And the title that they use for the Immaculate Heart of Mary is Cause of Our Joy. So I thought I was very touched, Marie, when you said that you recognize joy. and I'll just touch upon that, because Mother Teresa called the Blessed Mother Mary, the Immaculate Heart of Mary, the cause of her joy. And joy was very much at the heart of Mother Teresa's ministry among the poorest of the poor. Mother Teresa welcomed anyone with hands to serve and a heart to love to join her in her work, to serve others, to help others. If you had willing hands and a loving heart, you could help this saint. But you needed one more thing in order to help Saint Mother Teresa of Calcutta. In addition to hands to serve and a heart to love, you had to come with a smile. You had to come with joy. You had to come with a spirit of cheerfulness. And Mother Teresa herself explained, the people we are loving and serving, some of them are mentally ill, physically ill, unwanted abandoned babies, again, people with leprosy, people in their final agony, about to die. And Mother Teresa said, if we go to them with a sad face, we will only make them more depressed. So come with a smile. She said, joy is half the gift you bring. We give most to each other when we give with joy. And where did Mother Teresa get her joy? From Blessed Mother. Where did the Blessed Mother get her joy? Where did the Blessed Mother, Our Lady of Joy, get her joy? She tells us. Sweet Virgin Mary hardly says anything that's recorded in sacred scripture. So when she speaks, we should listen. Listen to what she already told us where she gets her joy. When she said, my soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord, and my spirit finds joy. Where? In God my Savior. Where does the Immaculate Heart of Mary find her joy? In God our Savior. Where can we find joy? In God our Savior, just like our Heavenly Mother. We're her children. We're her children. And so Mother Teresa's entire religious order is dedicated to Jesus and Mary, to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. And she said that we honor Our Lady, because this evening is about honoring our Blessed Mother Mary. And Mother Teresa said that we honor our Heavenly Mother by praying the Holy Rosary every single day, which is honoring her wishes. Blessed Mother tells us through the saints, pray the Rosary daily, pray the Rosary daily. So we honor her wishes, we honor her, respect her, and obey her by praying the Rosary daily, but also by imitating her kindness and thoughtfulness towards others. Mother Teresa loved how Blessed Mother was always thinking of the needs of others. Look at the wedding feast of Cana, when she interceded for the bride and groom, telling her son Jesus they don't have any more wine. You know, and because of that, she spared them the profound humiliation as bride and groom of running out of wine at their own wedding reception. So Blessed Mother was so thoughtful, even with that kind of matter, even with those matters, like running out of wine. But she was always thinking of the needs of others. How can I serve? How can I help? What did she say? I'm a handmaid of the Lord. You know, as if to put out her hands and say, I'm here to serve. I'm a handmaid. I'm a servant. You know, serving God by serving others. Mother Teresa, one of her favorite mysteries of the Most Holy Rosary of the Blessed Virgin Mary, one of her favorite mysteries was the second joyful mystery, called the Visitation, when the Blessed Mother Mary, after she became the Mother of our Lord, after the Annunciation, when the Holy Spirit came upon the Blessed Virgin Mary, and she conceived the Son of God, great will be his dignity, he will be called Son of the Most High. What did she do? When she became the Mother of God, the Mother of our Lord, she did not just go home and sit on the sofa eating bonbons. You know, she didn't just relax thinking, I'm now expecting, I better just stay home and eat candy. candy. You know, no, she was told by the angel Gabriel that your cousin, who's advanced in age, is also expecting a child and is in her sixth month. So Blessed Mother, even though she's the mother of our Lord, first let me say, Mother Teresa said that was Blessed Mother Mary's first Holy Communion, when Jesus came into her. You know, we receive Jesus, his flesh and blood, in Holy Communion, holy union with Christ. And when the Holy Spirit came upon the Blessed Virgin Mary, she conceived, she had the Christ within her. And Mother Teresa said that was her first Holy Communion. What did Blessed Mother Mary do when she received Holy Communion? She went to serve. She went in haste to the rugged hill country of Judea to help her cousin, who probably was in need, since, you know, at her advanced age, expecting a child. I'm here to serve. And Mother Teresa said that's our life too, to receive Jesus and then go share and love and serve and rescue and help others. That's our mission. We follow Blessed Mother. We follow Jesus, and that's what they teach us, to pour ourselves out the love of one another, to help, to have hands that serve, and a heart that loves, and what Mother Teresa called a joyful willingness to do even the most humble work for the poor, the sick, and the dying. And so those are some very important things about what's exciting is here we're celebrating 100 years of Our Lady of Fatima, and Father shared with us this evening that Sister Lucia had to remain on earth a bit longer to spread the devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. That's what she was commissioned by the Mother of our Lord to do. You know, Francesco and Jacinta will come to heaven soon, and as Father said, it was very soon, you know, within a couple of years that they were called home to God. But Lucia, you're to stay on earth a while longer to spread devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. A while longer, she's 97 years old, I believe. I mean, that's a while longer. And Jacinta, after being told she was going to heaven, you know, that's so beautiful, that's so comforting. But Jacinta's heart was so full of mercy and pity for Lucia. Like, you poor thing, you're going to be left alone, you poor thing. Jacinta really had mercy on Sister Lucia because those three were so close with each other. So for Lucia to lose her two best friends and to be left alone until the age of 97, that was a huge sacrifice, a huge penance. And little Jacinta would tell Lucia, I'll pray for you from heaven. Don't worry, I'll pray for you from heaven. But I'm very touched at what Our Lady said to Lucia. You know, when Lucia said to Our Lady, you're going to leave me here alone? Meaning, when these two go, you're going to leave me alone. And that's when Our Lady said, take courage. She said, my Immaculate Heart will be your refuge and the way that will lead you to God. Wow. What beautiful secrets. Snuggle close to the Blessed Mother's heart. Stay in the fold of her mantle. Stay close to her Immaculate Heart. This is our safe refuge. A refuge is a shelter. It's a safe place. It's your oasis of peace, your home, your safe place. Blessed Mother will take care of you, and she'll bring you to heaven, and she'll bring you to God. I mean, this is a secret that shouldn't be a secret, but spreading devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Mother Teresa was so devoted to the Immaculate Heart of Mary and was always obeying what Our Lady said at Fatima. Always obeying. For example, Mother Teresa said the rosary not only every day, many times every day. I don't know if you realize this, but Mother Teresa and the Missionaries of Charity even measured distance using decades of the rosary. So if you ask Mother or the sisters, how far is it from the orphanage to the home of the dying, they'd say, it's three decades of the rosary. And when I say that I knew Mother Teresa throughout the course of 11 years, it was not only in Calcutta, India, but it was also in the South Bronx and in Harlem, serving our country's poor to the poor. And whether we were walking the streets of the South Bronx, or I had the privilege of riding in the ambulance, Mother Teresa's ambulance, every day, from the orphanage to the home of the dying. And I'm telling you, we prayed the rosary, we prayed the rosary, we prayed the rosary. And even every evening at Holy Hour of Adoration with Mother Teresa and the Missionaries of Charity, the first half hour of that holy hour was we prayed the Holy Rosary together. And then the second half hour was silent adoration and prayer, just adoring Jesus and soaking up his love and his peace and his beauty and his goodness. So Mother Teresa throughout the day was praying the Rosary. I always feel when we pray the Holy Rosary, it's like holding the Blessed Mother's hand. It is so precious. And as Father said during tonight's rosary, when we were praying together, when our Lord Jesus was hanging on the cross, one of his precious final words, one of the things that our Savior himself, the Son of the living God, bequeathed to us during his final moments, his precious bequeathal to us, is his mama. He gave us his mom. I always consider some of the most precious gifts that our Savior gave us was he gave us his dad and he gave us his mom. We call his dad our father. We're his God's children. Wow. I mean, Jesus made God our father and he made Mary our mom. You know, St. Teresa of Lisieux used to say she's more a mother than a queen. And the little flower actually, instead of calling her mother in a formal way, she called her mama. You know, because it was more tender, more tender. We have the most beautiful, tender, perfect, pure, sweet, loving mother in the whole universe. How blessed we are as Christians to have the most beautiful mother in the whole world and in the whole universe. And again, so pray the Holy Rosary is honoring her. That's a commandment. You shall honor your father and your mother. You know, and so we're honoring her wishes. We're obeying her wishes when we say the rosary. And holding her hand when we say the rosary. But also, I want to remind you too that St. John, do you remember when Jesus said, "Behold your mother," when our Lord gave his life back to our Father, "Into your hands I commend my spirit." Scripture tells us that from that moment on, St. John took Blessed Mother Mary into his home. I am in awe of that. I think that's awesome. Can you imagine waking up every single morning and seeing the beautiful face of the sweet Virgin Mary, the mother of my Lord? Can you imagine saying, "Can I get you your coffee, Blessed Mother?" Like, what an honor to serve the Heavenly Mother, the mother of our Lord. Like, you get to see her every day. Like, "Good night, Mother. Good morning, Mother. Can I get you anything?" You know, he got to live with her. He took her into his home. And I heard it said years ago, and it was Father Mark at EW Chin, and he might have been quoting Pope John Paul II. I heard it said that every single time you say the Holy Rosary, you're bringing the Blessed Mother into your home. Just like St. John, you are just as privileged as St. John the Apostle, who stood before the cross and then got to live with Blessed Mother Mary every day, you know, thanks to Jesus giving his mother to us. Every time you say the Holy Rosary, you're bringing the Blessed Mother into your home. When I heard that, that makes me want to pray the Rosary at every moment. I want to live with her. I want to follow her to heaven. I want to love her and learn from her all the way how to get to heaven. She and Jesus, they are our way to heaven. And as you can see, they're kind of inseparable. You know, she's the mother of our Lord, and even the angel Gabriel said to her, "The Lord is with thee. The Lord is with you." That's a timeless statement. The Lord is always with her, you know, even right now. So when you settle close to the Blessed Mother Mary, you and Jesus are like this, because the Lord's with her. You know, it's so, if we half knew how beautiful your soul becomes, every time you receive Jesus in Holy Communion, and every time you pray the Holy Rosary, you never stop either one. You know, and that's another thing I want to share with you tonight about Blessed Mother Mary, and as Mother Teresa lived the messages of Fatima, it's not only her devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary and praying the Rosary and honoring Our Lady and being thoughtful and kind like our Blessed Mother Mary, because Blessed Mother Mary prefers imitation to admiration. And that's what the little flower said. She said, "Our Lady prefers imitation to admiration. Become like her. So that when you breathe your last breath and you appear before God Almighty, he can say, 'You resemble your mother. You look like your mother.' Because whoever you keep company with will rub off on you, for better or for worse. So keep good company. Keep holy companions, because you'll become like that companion. And you have the best and holiest and sweetest and most loving companion in the world when you hang out with Our Lady. And you can. She's so accessible. She's so approachable. You can be really close with Our Lady. You know, she's just a prayer away, a whisper away." But another part of the message of Fatima, one of the things that really should touch our hearts, is the reverence before Jesus in the Most Holy Eucharist. That those children were taught, they were taught by heaven itself, starting with the angel of peace, the angel of Portugal. The angel appeared to the children a whole year before Our Lady appeared to them, and the angel taught them to prostrate themselves before our Lord Jesus in the Most Holy Sacrament. And they said and were taught those prayers that we had said here this evening, guided by Father, like the prayer, "My God, I believe, I adore, I hope, and I love you," or especially, "O Most Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I adore thee profoundly." when the children learned those prayers from heaven, those prayers are given to us by heaven itself. They weren't made up by this man or that woman or that person. They were given by heaven itself, by an angel from heaven, and by Our Lady herself, these prayers that we learned from Fatima. But while they said these prayers, they prostrated themselves on the ground. And it reminds me of 2,000 years ago, whenever Jesus Christ came to town, people threw themselves down on the ground at His feet and worshipped Him. He's the Son of the living God. He's the Messiah. He's Jesus, the Son of God. And they would bow before Him, just like the children would talk to bow before His holy presence in the Most Holy Eucharist. And I had never in my life, until meeting Mother Teresa, seen such profound reverence in front of Jesus in the Most Holy Eucharist. Mother Teresa was 75 years old when I first met her in Calcutta, India. And she and I were kneeling in the very back of the chapel, the Mother House in Calcutta, a huge chapel. And when the priest held up the precious body of Jesus Christ during the consecration of the Mass, the sisters would be in such adoration of our Savior. And then when the priest placed the body of Christ back down on the altar, Mother Teresa, at age 75, kneeling on the floor, and all those sisters bowed right down to the floor, their forehead touching the ground. They prostrated themselves on the ground before the Savior. That's Jesus. It changed my life. To witness Mother Teresa and the sisters' reverence towards Jesus in the Most Holy Sacrament, I'm going to confess to you that when I first started going to daily Mass with Mother Teresa Missionaries of Charity, they would approach the altar with their hands folded in prayer like this. And just before they received Jesus in Holy Communion, the sisters would bow reverently and then receive Our Lord. And then the next sister would come up and bow reverently and then receive Our Lord. You see it more and more now, but back in the 1980s when I first met Mother Teresa, that wasn't happening so much. It wasn't something you saw. And when I saw Mother Teresa and the sisters really bowing deeply before receiving Holy Communion, I thought to myself the first days at Mass, I'm like, what are they doing? It's like they're bowing before a king. And I realized, it's because they can see through the eyes of faith who it is that they're about to receive. They're about to receive the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Messiah Himself, the bread from heaven. And they just had such faith that it changed my life. Because now, before meeting Mother Teresa, when I would approach the altar to receive Holy Communion, sometimes my thoughts were distracted, like, what's for Sunday dinner, you know? Or are any of my friends here at Mass today? You know, sometimes your thoughts would wander. But after witnessing a saint and witnessing the sisters receive the Most Holy Sacrament into their hearts, now when I come to the altar to receive Jesus, my attention is riveted, like I am about to receive the Holy One Himself, the Holy One of Israel, Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, the Son of the living God. He's about to come into my heart. Mother Teresa, again, we're talking about the Immaculate Heart of Mary, she taught us a secret. She said, if you're approaching the altar to receive the Son of God, receiving Jesus in Holy Communion, and you realize your heart isn't pure enough to receive the Holy One Himself, she said, of course, if it's serious sin, get to confession first, to get your soul washed clean, to receive Our Lord as worthily as you can. But if you're approaching the altar for Holy Communion, holy union with God, the Holy God, she said, and it's lesser sins, like maybe you were impatient with your spouse that morning, or not as patient with your child that morning, any lesser, you know, venial sins, this is the secret Mother Teresa taught me. She said, switch hearts with the Blessed Mother Mary. Give her your heart, you take her heart, before receiving Jesus in Holy Communion. And she actually taught us a prayer. She said, O Mary, Mother of Jesus, give me your heart, so beautiful, so pure, so immaculate, your heart so full of love and humility, that I may receive Jesus in the bread of life, and love Him as you love Him, and serve Him as you serve Him, and carry Him with the same sentiments and love with which you carry Jesus. I'm telling you, I use that prayer all the time, because as my father used to say, none of us are worthy to receive the Holy Communion, so I need her heart. And I feel too that when we switch hearts to the Blessed Mother Mary, and we give her our humble heart, our poor heart, and we take her Immaculate Heart, we get the better end of that deal, you know? And when you receive Jesus, He feels so at home with you. He feels so happy and at home with you, because you've got His mom's heart, and she's got yours. And she polishes it up and makes it far more beautiful. Beauty lies in the touch of her hand. She's full of grace, Mary Most Holy. And another thing too is Blessed Mother Mary told us, you know, told, as you may know, and just coming in your future presentations on the 13th of each month, is Our Lady showed the children hell. I don't know if you're familiar with the whole story of Fatima, but the Blessed Virgin Mary showed those three little children what hell looks like and said many souls are falling into hell because they know to pray for them and make sacrifices for them. And so she really commissioned these children to pray and to say this prayer often, especially when you're making a sacrifice. Oh my Jesus, this is the love of you, for the conversion of poor sinners, and in reparation for sins, gives the Immaculate Heart of Mary. And so Father spoke to us this evening about the thorns around the Immaculate Heart of Mary, and we are to make reparation for the sins committed against her most loving, pure, sweet heart, that many people are offending her. But you know what's stunning about the message of Our Lady of Fatima? Is she explained to us what those thorns are. Even our Lord Jesus explained to the children what those thorns are. It's not just the blasphemies against the Immaculate Heart of Mary, it's also, shockingly, the ingratitude towards her. I mean, and to our Lord too, the ingratitude wounds their loving hearts. You know, they've given us everything. She has given us everything. She gave us salvation. She said yes to God's plan and became the mother of our Lord and gave us a Savior because she said yes. And she stood at the foot of the cross, sacrificing her only son for our salvation. She didn't crumble and fall to the ground. She remained standing as a sign of strength, saying yes to God's will, no matter how hard it hurt. She made the supreme sacrifice, and Jesus made the supreme sacrifice. You know, and so the fact that people aren't grateful for all that they gave, he couldn't have given more. She couldn't have given more. He couldn't have poured himself out more. You know, this is my body given up for you. This is my blood poured out for your salvation. Like, he couldn't have given any more, and yet you look around the world, and who's saying thank you? Thank you. Thank you. Who's saying thank you, Blessed Mother? Thank you, Jesus. You know, there's so much indifference as if people think it's irrelevant, or what does that matter? It matters. At our last breath, it matters. None of us are so holy that we can ascend to heaven all by ourselves. We need Jesus. We need to be cleansed. We need him to save us. In the end times, he will open our graves and have us rise from them by his command. You know, he will raise us up because we have Jesus in us. We have his life. We have faith in us, which is a beautiful light of faith. But here he is saving our souls, saving us from the fires of hell. This is huge. I mean, hell is so serious. That's the price he had to pay. And he's holy. He didn't do anything wrong. He so saved us. And yet, again, how many of us are saying thank you? And when I see images of the Immaculate Heart of Mary surrounded by those piercing thorns, sometimes she's called, you know, Our Lady of Sorrows. And I always want to comfort her, Blessed Mother. You want to comfort her, and I want to pull out those thorns. I want to protect her heart. You know, you almost want to take the thorns yourself because I deserve it. She doesn't deserve it, you know. But I just want to protect her, and she has given us a way to comfort her heart, to pull out those thorns, you know, to love her back for all of her love. And that's the messages that you'll be continuing to hear, to say the rosary daily. And you're going to probably hear in the next months about the five First Saturday devotions. But again, make many sacrifices. And say this prayer often, especially when making a sacrifice. Let me, before I kind of conclude with a practical way of living the messages of Our Lady, the messages of Fatima, I want to share with you that, again, part of what I did with Mother Teresa was serve the orphans, serve people sick and suffering, serve the dying. I work in the Home for the Dying Destitute, the Home for the Dying. And Mother Teresa used to tell us to do small things with great love. You know, do ordinary things with extraordinary love. Love, love, love. St. Augustine said, we go to God not by walking, but by loving. You know, we love our way to heaven, and it's a commandment. You know, it's the greatest of all commandments is to love God with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength, and then to love our neighbor. And I used to wonder, how do we know if we're loving God with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength, and with every fiber of our being? Like, how are we doing on that? Like, how do you measure that? And Mother Teresa said something that, again, was life-changing. She said, we love God whom we cannot see by loving and serving those around us whom we can see. That's how we love God, by pouring our love for God out onto others, those around us. Love begins at home, Mother Teresa said, family first. And so while I was with Mother Teresa, I learned more from a saint how to love, how to serve, but also how to receive Jesus every day first, and then go and love. Remember, like the Blessed Mother Mary is her role model. You receive Jesus first, and then you go in haste to love and serve others, because that's what love does. God is love. And so my nephew Patrick, when he was about 4 years old, he said, everybody has a good amount of love of God in them. Everybody has a good amount of God in them. You have God in you. And we have to let God shine. Let your light shine. God is the light. Father spoke again this evening from the message from June 13th. They were in the light of God. These three children of Fatima were in the light of God. And I think it's so touching, so poignant how the two littlest ones, Jacinta and Francesco, the light that they were in was going towards heaven. It was rising up towards heaven. And the light that Lucia was in was spreading out on earth. And I was just reading, just last night, Sister Lucia's own words about Fatima. And I was on a section about Francesco, and he was in awe. Francesco was in awe about that light. They were in the light of God, and he would marvel at that light that they saw. And he asked Lucia, you know, they would talk about, why did ours go up and yours stay here? And it was because the two children were going to heaven soon, and Lucia and the Immaculate Heart of Mary, Lucia and Our Lady were going to stay on earth, just spread the light of God on earth. You know, and I find that really exciting. Sometimes I wonder, since reading that, where is our light going? am I ready to come home soon, Lord? Or am I to keep spreading this love on earth? You know, am I to help, peace help saving souls? And because that's the secret of Fatima. Fatima, to me, is about saving souls, you know, from the fires of hell. Especially those who are dear to us. Every day I would pray the Holy Rosary with my mom and dad. And our battle cry, spiritual battle cry, I'm one of 10 children. I'm never 7. And mom and dad called us the 10 treasures. You know, I remember when I was a little girl, I overheard my father say to my mother, we might not have much money in the bank, but we've got our 10 treasures. And they felt rich because they had us. We children were their wealth. We were their treasures. And now they have grand treasures, you know. But when you have children and grandchildren, they are your treasures. That's your life. That's part of you. And so our spiritual battle cry, when mom and dad and I would pray the rosary every single day, was, let not one be lost. Let not one be lost. You know, don't let any of these treasures go the wrong way. Bring them to heaven. Let's guide them, or bring them safely to heaven. And dad felt responsible for our immortal souls. You know, that he felt that God entrusted our souls to mom and dad, and their job was to get us safely back home to God. And so, Blessed Mother, that's what Fatima is about, to rescue souls from the fires of hell. You know, lead them to Jesus, lead them safely home to heaven, keep them in moonlight. You know, they say the Holy Rosary is Our Lady's lasso. You know, it looks like it. You know, you in the cowboy movies and you throw the rope, and what do you get, cattle or something, or horses? I don't know what you get, but it's to get a hold of something to pull it close to yourself so it doesn't get lost and run away. You know, so this is Our Lady's, how do you even say it? I guess I'm not a cowgirl. Lasso. So, you know, this is, you just keep saying this for your treasures and for your grand treasures and save them. I'll share with you that the sweetest privilege of my whole life, hands down, the greatest privilege of my whole life is receiving Jesus in Holy Communion. It's so awesome. My father said, used to say, if we half realized what takes place on the altar every single time we approach to receive Jesus in Holy Communion, he'd say we want to crawl on our hands and knees to that altar to receive Christ. He'd say that we're not worthy. Dad was so cognizant of the fact, what a holy privilege. It's the sweetest privilege of my life. You get to hug Christ in Holy Communion, holy union with God. And as I think it was St. John Vianney said, every time you receive Holy Communion, do you realize the precious blood of the Savior is flowing through your veins? And the flesh of God, the flesh of our Lord Jesus, is blended with your flesh. You and God are so close that you're one. You're so close to Christ as to be one with Christ. That's what holiness is. You're called to holiness, I'm called to holiness. And so the greatest privilege of our life, for all of us, is to be so close to God in holy union, holy communion, just like the Blessed Mother. Well, I'll tell you, to kind of let you understand the practical lesson of Our Lady of Fatima, is one of the other sweet privileges of my life, is after I came home from India, serving with Mother Teresa, and over the course of years, learning from Mother Teresa, how to love and serve better, how to love and serve from a saint, watching her love others and shine her love on others. One of the other privileges of my life was serving as my mom's primary caregiver to mom's last breath. She's the heart of our family, our mom. Remember, my two favorite female role models are Blessed Mother and my mom. And in India, Mother Teresa taught me to love and serve those who are sick and dying. When I came home to Maine, I was able to love and serve my own mom. And then after mom was taken home to heaven, then I served as my father's primary caregiver, taking care of my dad for the last 4.5 years of my dad's life. And when you're a caregiver for somebody, I had a little hospital room in my own home, in our home. I came back home to our family home, and we set up a hospital room. And I took care of mom and then dad there. And at the foot of his hospital bed, I had a commode. And part of my duty every day was emptying dad's commode. And it's one of the lowliest tasks I've ever done in my life, and I loved it. And it was an honor. My dad would apologize to me and say, I'm so sorry to put you through this. I'm so sorry you have to do this to me. And I would smile at my father and I'd say, Dad, this is an honor. And I'd say, Dad, this is my way to heaven. I meant it. This is our way to heaven. And every day when I would do that lowly task of emptying my dad's commode, you know what I would do? Blessed Mother Mary taught us to make sacrifices and to offer them up to God to save souls and to help souls. She said, say this prayer often, especially when you're making a sacrifice. So every day when I emptied the commode, I'd say, oh my Jesus, this is for love of you and for the conversion of poor sinners, and in reparation for sins against the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Engrave that prayer on your heart. Engrave that prayer in your mind. And even if you can't remember the entire prayer, remember the first part of it. Every day, whatever you do, say, oh my Jesus, this is the love of you. My Jesus, this is the love of you. My Jesus, this is the love of you. As Father alluded to, Jesus on the cross is thirsting. He is thirsty for our love. And so many souls are completely indifferent, completely neglecting him, completely ignoring him, and he's giving his life for love of us. But he's thirsting for love and for the salvation of souls. This is what this is all about. If you want to know what love is, love equals sacrifice. Love equals suffering. This is love. He didn't hold anything back. He poured himself out like a libation to save you and to save you. He took the bullets. We dodged the bullet, everybody, and he took them all. And now we get to live forever. We get everlasting happiness, everlasting love, everlasting peace, because love, this is love. And so we, as St. Francis of Assisi used to say, you go around, you know, a companion of St. Anthony of Padua, St. Anthony of the world, an actual contemporary, an actual companion. St. Francis of Assisi would go around Assisi saying, love is not love. Love is not love. He is love. God is love. And nobody's loving him back. And he's thirsting for our love and for our salvation to get us all home safely to heaven. You know, and so that, again, is part of what Fatima is all about, is love him, thank him, you know, praise him, adore him, comfort him, and console her. Console Blessed Mother. From now on, let everything you do be done for love of Jesus and also for love of the Sweet Heart of Mary. I love little Jacinta. Oh, do I love that little Jacinta. Everything she says, I'm like, amen, amen. Like, she just kept saying how I love the Immaculate Heart of Mary, how I love the Sweet Heart of Mary. She just couldn't stop talking about that Sweet Heart of our Blessed Mother, how she loved Our Lady. And I keep writing in my book when I read these quotes, I'm like, me too, me too. But we know what it takes to make Our Lady smile. And I just long for us from this day forward, give God joy. Give Blessed Mother joy. Make our mother happy. How blessed we are to be their children. What an honor, you know, to serve so great a king and to have so loving and perfect and pure and loving a mother. So I'll end with a little prayer. I could keep going. I could keep going. But we have, I have refreshments and stuff for you. But this prayer was something Mother Teresa said every day, every day. As a matter of fact, one of the books that I have over in the Paris Center is Mother Teresa's own prayers. And there's a whole chapter of the Immaculate Heart of Mary on Our Lady and what Mother Teresa, how Mother Teresa loved Our Lady. But one of the prayers Mother Teresa said frequently throughout the day, certainly every day, was this: Immaculate Heart of Mary, cause of our joy, pray for us, bless us, keep us in your most pure heart, help us to do all the good we can, so that we may please Jesus, through you, with you, and in you. Immaculate Heart of Mary, cause of our joy, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.